to improve ductility on beam column joint. You see here, it is a framed structure, and in between the frame you have a beam column joint. While constructing the beam column joint, what are the points to be taken for designing as well as detaining, which will be discussed today. The forces will be large at the junctions only. When you compare the forces occur in a column and force which occur in the horizontal members, which are beam and slab, the joints carry higher loads, so it has to be taken some attention. When you repair a beam separately, you can repair a column separately, but if you want to repair this kind of joint, it is difficult. In the junction, you will be having two different elements, column and beam. So if you want to chip out, make rehabilitation work, it takes much complicated work. So while designing, you have to design it properly, particularly the beam column joint. Rest of the elements can be rehabilitated easily. If the column has been damaged, you can support by using props at the sides. Both the sides you can provide the support, and you can remove the column and you can reinstall new column. This could be done. Beam also you can do it separately, but beam column joint is a difficult one to make the repairing. For this purpose, you have to design and detail the beam column joint in a ductile mode. What will be the behavior of joints during an earthquake? If a member has been applied with horizontal force, it has been deflecting from one place to another, what happens? Bending in the member occurs. So in a bending, you will be having bottom side as tension, the bottom part will be having one stress, and top part you have another kind of a stress. Generally, if you load the beam in a vertical mode, you will be having bottom tension and top compression. But in earthquake force, the force will act laterally in horizontal direction along with the load which is coming on top. So what happens if the element is compressed and tensioned? It will get push and pull. So due to this push and pull, what happens? The member in between the column and beam will be taking compression and tension load. So this is compression and this is tension. Imagine you apply some lateral force in a rubber. If you apply that, the rubber will be tensioning and compression when it is subjected to horizontal force. If you are turning to and fro, it gets tension and compression at the other side. Its elasticity is higher to take. If you do it for any biscuit, if you do it for any hard member called concrete, this kind of elasticity will not be there in the member. So that due to lack of elasticity, the member gets cracked. And another point you can observe is, you have three different material. Take an example in your classroom, you have glass, you have wall which is constructed of brick, and the concrete member. You can expect the member glass to get cracked first. Why? Because within this three member, which is having less elasticity, glass is having less elasticity, isn't it? So glass you cannot extend and compress, it is highly brittle member. So during an earthquake, first the glass will get cracked, next your walls will get cracked, finally the beam or column will get cracked. Why? What is the reason? Elasticity plays an important role here. So you have to improve that elasticity in order to sustain cracks. Sir, I want to construct a building. So during an earthquake, my structure should not get cracked. So what you have to do? You have to increase your flexural strength. In concrete structures, you would have gone through this topic, flexural rigidity. What do you mean by flexural rigidity? Flexural rigidity called EI. E is what? Young's modulus. I is called moment of inertia. If you have E and I, the terminology is called what? Flexural rigidity. So if you are reading the books, in theoretical aspect, they would have discussed this. If you increase flexural rigidity, it gives more strength to column. It reduces the crack. You need elasticity as well as rigidity. So, can you accept your building to vibrate like a rubber? No, you cannot expect. It should be rigid also. It should be flexible and rigid. That's why the terminology is used called flexural rigidity. It should be rigid also flexibility, which is given by the steel and concrete. The steel is a flexural member. Concrete is a rigid member. So you are combining these two. This increases the flexural rigidity. What is the reason of constructing shear wall? I have earlier said shear wall is construction of a wall by using concrete and steel. So if you are constructing a shear wall, which helps during the seismic force. So it has more flexural rigidity, hence it can withstand the force. The cracks will not get developed. Let us see the behavior. Under an earthquake, the beam will be subjected to a movement in lateral direction or longitudinal direction. It experiences one is clockwise movement or anti-clockwise movement. This could happen. If earthquake is coming in this side, this beam can rotate like clockwise or anti-clockwise. It will be rotating like this. So due to this, there will be cracks due to tension and compression. In a circumstance, the bar slips inside the joint region and beam lose their capacity. You have steel and around the steel you have concrete. So the grip should not be left. Concrete and the steel should have a grip. If the grip is being left, what happens? At that point you will be having the cracks. So these are the reasons for during an earthquake why does crack occur. How to increase the strength of a joint? You have to provide ties or stirrups in this junction. So they have given clear detailing in this picture how to lay a ties. Have you seen a ties which is provided in this area, in this junction of two area anywhere? Have you seen this kind of brown color ties? Anywhere they have installed? Generally they will not install, but in IS 13920 they insist that you have to provide ties, at least a three number of ties in this junction. Sir, how to provide the ties? It is very jam and it is compacted with all the reinforcement. See, you have four sides and at all the sides you have stirrups. So for working it is difficult. So for that they have given this image. Without connecting the stirrup, the longitudinal bar should be placed here. And you should provide a temporary support. What is temporary support? Is a bit rod. So you should provide a rod like this. Above that rod you should lay the reinforcement. This reinforcement is beam reinforcement. So below that you have to lay this three stirrups. So this three stirrups should be laid below first. After that you have to install the reinforcement. So what generally the laborers will do is, soon after the column rod is being laid, they will soon erect the beam rods. So before inserting the beam rod, first thing what you have to do, three number of ties should be placed here. Then you have to lay the supports here, temporary support, and after that in the temporary support you have to lay the stirrups. Now what happens, you will be having some space to lay the stirrups. So what I am discussing now, you will be not aware, but those who are working as a site engineer, at that point of time you will remember. One tie to another tie, you can use 75 to 100 mm between these. So if you provide this, what happens? Your building will perform ductile manner. Diagonal crack and crushing of concrete in a joint region is prevented by using this kind of stirrups. One thing. Now second, using large column size. When designing, you should not use lesser size of column and larger size of beam. So here, what is larger, either beam or column? Column is larger. If you go out and see, the column dimensions only are half is here, but remaining half is at outer. You check that the column dimension is much higher than the beam dimension. So it says that using large column sizes is the most effective way to achieve this. How to prevent the beam column joint? Larger column size and smaller size beam. This is one of the technique. and closed space loop at the steel ties. So this is what closed spaced loop at the joint regions. Intermediate column bar are also effective in confining the joint concrete to resist horizontal shear force. So intermediate column bars you can use, intermediate is you can join at the lap space only, not at the corners. So the lap should be at the intermediate. How to make development length is, this is a bad practice. Why? Because if you want to connect these two rods, the beam rod should go to the bottom of the column. You can see here, this beam top rod is going to the bottom of the column and bottom rod should go to the top of the column. This kind of connection is difficult. During practice also it is difficult. So do not follow this narrow column technique. For that you can use in ACI. ACI is American Concrete Institute. They suggest that as a designer, if you are designing the column, widen the column. This is one of the advantage. If you are taking as a lap length or anchorage, so they say to do lap or anchorage length. See, the beam rods has to be inserted here. And why you are bending the beam rods at the corner? The code says that if you are extending a rod and if you bend to 90 degree, it gives 4 times dia of lap length. And if you make a U-hook, what do you mean by U-hook is, this is 90 degree of hook. You can bend this bar to 180. You can bend this bar to 180 degree. If you bend the bar like this, it gives 16 times dia of strength. That is 4 times more powerful. Currently in your book you cannot see. When I was studying diploma, when way before 20 years, in my class text note, it is given all the rods are bend in U-hook only. If you are placing a ship without placing any anchor, what happens? Due to tide or wave, the ship can or the boat can go in any way, yes or no. Like that, the beam also has to get the anchorage. It should have anchor. This is called anchor. Okay. Now, next practice is anchorage or bond of a beam. Can you see this kind of failure? At the beam column joint, the concrete fails. The concrete is being disrupted and crack occurs at this point. This is due to anchorage deficiency. Okay. There is also another construction difficulty is, you want to take the beam rod in a straight way. You will be having column also. Now, how you are going to construct? Your beam size and column size are same. Your beam rod has to go and column rod has to go. Both will meet at one point. No. How you are going to detail on that? The column rods are straight, beam rods also straight. At particular point it gets collision. So how you are going to manage this? Practically they use like this. They will use one kink. So I have already said what do you mean by kink, K-I-N-K. They use some kink and they will do like this. This rod will be there, slight bend, and they will extend this and make the construction. This is a poor practice. You should not do like this. For that, what you have to do? You have to design. In design also, you have to take care of this. The beam rod should be straight. Column rod should be straight. And you should design in a such a way that a designer should keep the mind of a site engineer. The site engineer should always keep in mind what designer thinks. This designer says that site engineer is making a poor practice. And site engineer says that designer is a waste fellow. He doesn't know what is civil engineering. He is just giving some reinforcement. Who has to construct? How you can construct? He will ask that. So both should work in a compromised way. So what is the thing is, you have to reduce the size of beam and the column size has to be extended. This is one of the reasons. So if you follow these practices, what you can do? what you can do? You can make the building into ductile resistant, ductile reinforced structure. What happens if you make your structure into ductile? It will not collapse during an earthquake.